So, hello, everyone.
Hi. Hello.
Hello. For those of you who are watching for the first time, this is the Tech Rally Game Space.
Yeah.
Lesson night.
Awesome. All right,
so, first thing we're going to do is introduce ourselves, and then each of the panelists are going to pass around a hat and pull a question out, in which they can read the question, answer it, and if any of the other panelists wish to chime in on that question, they can, after which the hat can be passed to someone else and another question can be asked. So introduce yourselves, please.
I'm Frederika Edgington-Giordano. I've been here, how long have I been at Tech Rally Game Space? Been a couple of years, yeah. I volunteered here. I have made games for several Ludum Dare game jams, a couple global game jams. I've also made games for some online itch.io game jams, which were a bit longer. So I've done the 72 hours, the shorter, like 48 hours. That's like what the, yeah, it's, well, not, I've not done the compo for Ludum Dare, but for global game jam, that's a bit shorter. So I've worked on my own. I've worked with teams. So I'm not an artist or a musician. So I've had to rely on either teammates or, free assets. So I can talk about that. So yeah, that's me, I think, in a nutshell.
Hello, my name is Taro Omiya, co-founder of the Tech by Game Space and founder of Omiya Games. If you have found me via Omiya Games, you probably know that I make way too many games. I've been participating in as many Ludum Dares as possible. I am one of the organizers of that here at the venue. Yeah, I've done both compo and jam. I primarily focus on jam largely because of the fact that I too am not an artist or a musician, and so any free assets I can get, I will take advantage of. For those not in the know, compo has a rule set where you cannot do that. Anyways, yeah, there's a lot. There's a couple of other game jams I have done, including Global Game Jam, Bacon Game Jam, and others. So I can talk bits and pieces about each, and yeah, I can provide some thoughts on that.
Hello, everyone. My name is Muse and Lystrala. I am the executive director of Queenship Game Studio right here in Troy. I found my way into game development after a lengthy directorship with my classical ensemble, Geek Musica, which performs video game and film music, and which I still direct. I found out about the Ludum Dare game jams here at the Game Space, and I realized that I was really interested in composing music for video games, so I started doing Ludum Dare this year, and I think I'm coming up on my fourth Ludum Dare this month. And I've done one global game jam so far, and to date, I have composed music for 6 indie games. One of which is going to be Queenship's first game coming out this fall, so we're pretty excited about it. And I work with Frederika at Queenship as well, and she, no, it's okay, she is awesome. We love her. I haven't done any compo game jams yet because I am not that brave, and also I don't really code very much. So 72 hours is kind of my shtick. So. So yeah.
So who wants to pull the first question?
Oh, I guess I could.
make sure you.
I started with Frederika. Okay. I started with Frederika because I was thinking to myself, left to right, but we're actually now going right to left.
Yeah, we're backwards here. Okay, yeah. Well, that's fine. All right, so the question is, what aspects of game design would you focus on to get a game done? Well, generally what you should do with focus on with game design is the bare minimum which to make a game and make it interesting. And then you generally kind of prioritize your ideas. You're always going to drop something, so you're better off kind of figuring out what would be okay to drop, what would be less okay to drop, when what's absolutely crucial for the game to be worth the time and effort. So that's basically So it depends on the type of game. I actually primarily do like narrative games, but I have done games with using Construct, Unity a little bit, just a tiny bit. But yeah, you want to prioritize and focus on what you're like your minimum viable product kind of demo kind of game. So that.
Anybody have additional things?
Everything Frederika said, I say that almost I tend to humble brag / cry to myself that all my game design documents can are just a single sentence long. But generally speaking, if you're coming up with a game idea and you're trying to keep it to a minimal product, an easy way of coming of an easy limitation that is worth following in approaching a game jam is to start with, you know, a single sentence description of how to play and what the game is going to be about. That can be summarized in just a single sentence or two. I'm willing to stretch up to two, but no more than that.
All of the above also. but I think the definitely just kind of not condensing, but almost like just kind of frameworking your game appropriately is very important. Like, I mean, you might really want, you know, like super fancy graphic art, but you might not have time to do it in 72 hours. But in my mind, like the object of a game jam is to develop even a few minutes long basic working prototype that you can continue to work on and expand later. And like a ton of game jam games wind up being like, you know, shipped products later, whether it's months later, years later, et cetera, et cetera. So basically, when you enter a game jam, you're not growing a whole plant, you're kind of making a seed, if that makes sense. So if you want to kind of visualize it as, you know, just sort of a basic foundation upon which you can build, that's a really good way to go about it.
Tips for creating teams during a game jam. Oh, this is a fantastic question. People are probably going to disagree with me on this. My philosophy on creating a team for a game jam is to first search for team members that agree with your vision. Not who are friends with you. This might come as a shocker, but the reason why I personally have that sort of philosophy is that if everyone is motivated to work on a single goal, then a lot of disputes are easier to resolve. Now there are obviously a lot of edge cases that I could easily name, but that's not the point of this conversation. So that's currently my philosophy behind that. Obviously, like huge obviously, in regards to creating a team, you definitely want to cover a basis of what you're weak at if you are the idea person in this case. If you are literally weak at everything, then you better start putting yourself up on a stool for taking on any sort of hat that is necessary, because especially in a game jam environment, chances are very high you're not going to be able to cover all bases that you had in mind. So you will have to fill those holes as necessary. But let's say you are a coder and you are not an artist or a musician, then yes, definitely look for a sound designer and an artist. If you're an artist, definitely look for a coder and a sound designer, so on and so forth. I would also mention that personally speaking, smaller teams are much more favorable. I prefer a team size of 3. That is by and far my favorite number when it comes to teams. 4 is actually pretty good as well. Anything beyond below or above that is usually a lot tougher. Those are my opinions. Feel free to fight it in the comments. Any speakers would like to add to this?
I agree with Taro, but only up to a point. for me personally, like, I don't necessarily have to be best friends or anything with the people I'm working with. In fact, very often the people I wind up working with on game jams are people that I've like just met. But I feel like it's important if you're going to do a game jam, you know, to show up to the preliminary activities and not just meet people that are like, you know, kind of aiming to do the same kind of games as you, but people you can get along with because it reduces friction. Like, I really like to work with people that I could at least get along with. Like, you know, I haven't known Frederika or Taro for very long, but like, I like them both very much. And subsequently, it's very easy for me to work with them because there's a good level of, you know, communication and, you know, mutual willingness to understand the other person's perspective. That being said, a lot of the game developers I've met, and that includes myself, we're a little awkward as a collective. So sometimes making conversation about things can be a little bit difficult at game jams, especially, you know, since everybody's very hyper-focused on, the theme or the object or whatever the game jam is about. So something to kind of keep in mind, I guess.
So I've had a few experiences with working with teams, working with by myself, working with a team where it was just me and people I knew and pretty much set out to work with, well, my husband mostly, and then working with rather large teams, actually, much larger than suggested. But actually, I find they're very different experiences. Working by myself, it doesn't go very far. It's actually, I've probably had my worst jam when I was just working all completely on my own. Working in a small team, it was a mixed kind of bag. Sometimes it goes well, sometimes it, at least from my personal experience, sometimes it doesn't necessarily go as well as it could. It sort of depends on how much time I'm able to put in. A small team and I'm not able to put in a lot of time, that's really bad. but I've had really my best experiences working with bigger teams. Like my first global game jam, I was on like a team of like 7 people. and then there was also a Ludum Dare 42 where we made open spaces. Yeah. Now that was a lot of fun. Yeah, I think about 5, yeah. That was great. But what's really interesting when you work on a large team is and you just, you know, kind of go, and in those cases we were going around the same game idea and we were mostly interested in the game idea. It was really kind of neat because, and challenging because other people had skill sets sometimes. Sometimes you're going to have 2 programmers interested in making a game, the same game. So that kind of puts you in a different kind of, maybe you have to challenge yourself, especially with a large team. I actually seem to For the global game jam, I was kind of found myself in a sort of project management kind of position. So I was kind of keeping track of, okay, does everyone have their contact info? When is everyone coming in? And that was really challenging because sometimes people weren't actively working on anything because they didn't have anything to work on. But it was a good challenge. It was a really good learning experience. So having a large team can be very beneficial if everyone or mostly everyone is getting along. We had some friction. If you have a large enough group, you'll have some friction. But it was a really positive experience overall.
Now that all that bases are covered, I only have a few more things to add, but actually there are probably going to be many. Large teams. If you start having a team size of, I would say maybe 6 or more, 5 is kind of stretching it, but 6 or more, you will want at least one person designated as a project manager, without a question. Because that, believe it or not, approximately around that team size, things does get very unwieldy very quickly, in my opinion. So definitely have one person that is the primary vision and of that team and be able to communicate with and coordinate with all the team members to say, like, these are the features we must put in. These are the features we will just redline or just give up on because they're taking up too much of our time. So definitely when you have a larger team size, again, 6 or up, start looking for a project manager. Because you're going to need it. I was going to say, also, it depends on which game jam you're aiming for. If the game jam is already, like, let's say, empathy game jam, then the topic is already determined, and you can enter with a team if you wanted to. However, if you are entering, say, Ludum Dare, where the topic is not determined at all, it's going to be announced at the very, very beginning of the game jam, I do not recommend walking in with a team. I highly recommend walking with a friend, but go in with an assumption that you're not going to be working with them.
Right.
Because the theme itself is going to have you probably change your idea of what game you're going to end up making. Mm-hmm. And consequently, the same thing's going to happen in your friends' minds as well. So that makes it very hard to have you to kind of agree upon a single game to work on, because you're both going to be both attached to your own games. I'm obviously running with an assumption here, but I feel like that happens far too often for a lot of people that walk into like Global Game Jam, Ludum Dare, and be like, all right, we're going to work as a team because we're already in it. And then they learn about the theme and they have a very, 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 very long like brainstorming session where the entire team can't even agree on a single game idea. So I don't... when you have that sort of situation, I don't recommend walking in with a team. I would assume that you're going to be pairing yourself up with some complete stranger at that point.
We should move on to the next question.
Yeah, definitely.
Have you attended game jams before? Yes.
That's not fair. Take a look.
Several, in fact.
We already said it.
Have you worked on or made a game before? Yes, I have. Several. Everyone at the table has worked on and made games. Taro is a prolific game maker, which I feel a little embarrassed about, honestly, because you just hear, oh, it's making games. So I guess I'll talk about a couple of games I maybe not made but worked on. I have two favorites out of all the games that I've made, I've done for game jams. The first is a game called Hatchy Block, which was one of Taro's projects, and it's like Tetris but not. So I think I'll let Taro talk about it a little bit more. But I really love block style games like, Tetris and that whole, theme. I think it's probably because I have high spatial intelligence. I'm just really into that sort of thing. I didn't really do a lot of musical work for that particular game, but I did this kind of a neat little like electro style soundtrack for it. And I had a really good time kind of composing that. My other favorite is Open Spaces, which Queenship is working on, as has been mentioned, was the result of Ludum Dare 40. Was it 42 or 43? Okay. It's 42. It's 42, which seems a little fortuitous, really. So Open Spaces is a visual novel about agoraphobia and anxiety, and that Ludum Dare's theme was running out of space. So we kind of, Mahua, who is the game's creator and also works on the Queenship team, she kind of took that in a direction of, mental health, and she's like, well, what causes you to run out of space mentally? Anxiety is a pretty good example of that. So is agoraphobia, just cognitively running out of spoons. So we had this really wonderful team, all women, which was great, except for Anthony provided like a bunch of great resources, but everybody who worked in this space physically on the game was women. So it was just a bunch of us just coming up with all these great ideas, and there was wonderful art. I had a really great time composing the music. Frederika did the the coding and the game engine stuff. Mahua did the writing. Didn't Tess work on that too? The initial prototype, yeah. So it was a really good time, not least because we produced a really wonderful game and we got great responses online to it. But it was just a really wonderful and collaborative experience. And I think that's when I decided I wanted to run a game studio. So, yay!
So Hachi Block was mentioned real briefly. Hachi Block is a lot like Luminous, if anyone has played that game. Yeah, Luminous is a fun game. It's also patented, so I had to work around the patents. That was really fun to work on. Anyways, I kind of want to, before I go talk about a few of my favorite projects, I wanted to briefly cover, like, I feel like that question kind of asks the question of, you know, do I need to know how to make a game? Do I need to study on, like, game engines and stuff like that? While recommended, I don't think that is absolutely necessary at all. I'm sure both Muse and Frederika will vouch that. You can definitely get into this starting from scratch. I think you'll be a significant leg up. You'll have a significant leg up in approaching a game jam if, for example, you know how to make digital art. If, for example, you know how to make scripts, or you know how to compose music, you know how to record sound effects, so on and so forth. So those sort of skill sets are really useful. I would also say that learning a game engine is also very useful as well. But before everyone kind of goes out and run off and say, like, okay, well, I better start learning coding then, stop. There's plenty of game engines out there that are very, very easy to learn. And starts with an assumption that you as a user do not know how to code. And Frederika, I'm sure, can go into huge amount of depths as to what sort of resources are out there for people who don't know, even know how to code yet. So there are some limitations to a few of them, but I think those are, without a question, a fantastic starting point. And so with that in mind, like, you know, don't think, if you think to yourself, like, I've never done this before, or like, I don't have a computer that's very, very strong, like, can I really do this? The answer is you can. Those are not, we like to think of the, I mean, people will probably think of those as sort of like a constraining limitation, but I like to think of it as an opportunity for more creative ideas. So definitely start off with thinking of it that way. So going back to the actual question, I personally like to make a lot of unusual games. Katamari Damacy in particular is one of my favorite, one of my inspirations for getting into game development. So with that in mind, like the two games that I personally have the most fondness towards is Through Oneself and Suddenly Thousands. Those are the two games that immediately comes to my mind. My claim to fame is the recursive dollhouse, and I'll talk about that last. All of these are actually puzzle games, which is something that I do a pretty good job at. But if you were to like look through like even the first few games on my list, you're going to quickly find out, like, I tried to cover nearly as many game genres as possible. But anyways, let's start with Through Oneself. My goodness, Through Oneself is really difficult to describe in words because you just have to see it. But it is, you play as a controllable silhouette, and the silhouette completely breaks all the visual occlusion rules that you know of. When I say visual occlusion, I mean if there's a big object in front of you, it will block, and if there's somebody else behind it, you won't be able to see that person behind, right? That's how physics and light works. My game completely breaks that rule entirely. And you have this character where the silhouette of that character allows you to see like a completely different dimension, a completely different world that only she can interact with. And believe it or not, that game was actually over-engineered. If you were to, it is an open source project, if memory serves correct. If you were to view the source, you're going to quickly find out that I tried adding this like Pikmin aspect to it, where you can have these little followers walking around, but that never made it into the game. Originally, like, I had this storyline in mind where like this character would be like a sort of forced in a situation lone wolf, in that she's not able to interact with either characters from either of the worlds. So that was actually the main purpose of why there's a lot of people running around, even though like you can't talk to them. There's nothing you can do with them. They're just there as flourishes. So I don't think I did a pretty good job of getting that idea across. It's just a puzzle game, especially with a Jolly Wally super optimistic tune on there when I had like this much more deeper and much more dark story in mind. But, you know, I'm just still compelled by the idea of this character that's kind of stuck between these two worlds and doesn't do a good job of filling it into either of them. And so I still feel like there's a really, really huge narrative potential behind the game. And that's kind of what still keeps that game in the back of my mind to this day. Suddenly Thousands was a game that I kind of made by accident. It was for Bacon Game Jam, and originally I had this like strange Watch Dogs idea of it's just Watch Dogs / Hitman idea, where like you had all the social media stuff that you need to look through to find your victim, and then from there try to crowd control the situation. And this was far over scope, by the way. Bacon Game Jam is only 48 hours long, and I was doing it entirely solo, and that was a really stupid idea. But I accidentally dropped like two characters that were player controlled in the game, and I just thought that was a much more interesting game, just being able to control multiple characters that all followed synchronously followed your controls around. So I just made a game surrounded around that. And like the characters being slower than you or faster than you is a complete accident. This game was like one accident after another, one happy accident after another. Like that one, the script itself was programmed such that the length of the character's leg animation would determine how fast they would run. So I just kind of ran with that, and I just thought that was made for a compelling experience. At the time, I was just like trying to make that game in 48 hours. But like once I finally posted it up and I just kind of played it for myself, I thought like, you know, this is a game about management. This is a game about the difficulties of being a team leader in a project where everyone is in tune, everyone is trying to make the same thing, like everyone wants the same, you know, goal, but everyone does not have the same skill set and the struggles of trying to manage that. So I thought like that was a really cool narrative opportunity in that game as well. And like to this day, like I'm still compelled to like go back and see like what other forms of things to really compel the player to think over like what, you know, what sort of special power some of these characters have that, you know, makes it easier or harder to curate all the characters and all the characters that you can control in that game. There's just so many cool opportunities that I had would like really force the player to kind of think back to their own life and kind of think back like how difficult it is to just kind of work with people. But at the same time, how satisfying it is to get as many of those into into the final goal as possible. And finally, the recursive dollhouse. My claim to that score number one on innovation for Ludum Dare 37. And yeah, I mean, that one came out from a Japanese show that I really, really liked. And I mean, I think it does have some narrative opportunities behind it. You can already see a string of reasons why I think some games are more interesting than others. I think that game does have some potential, but it's something that I'm just going to have to sit down and ask, like, what mechanic or what kind of story would really convince a player to willfully suspend their disbelief and understand that there's this recursive set of dollhouses that you keep shrinking yourself into further and further as you go along. So I haven't really thought that part through yet, But to describe the game, it's about jumping into one dollhouse, into another dollhouse that's inside that dollhouse, into another dollhouse that's already inside that dollhouse, into so on and so forth ad infinitum. It is a puzzle game. A lot of it is about how to get in deeper, because there's often doors that keeps you from getting into there. Yeah, that's about it. You should totally play it. They're all free.
I've worked on a few different games. The first game jam game I worked on was with my husband. Was first Ludum Dare. I don't remember which number it was, but it was like changing shape or something like that. And it was a really simple game, very very straightforward, but it was fun to work on, and kind of got me started in thinking in terms of like how to tell a player what's happening in a game. So that was kind of a fun idea, though it wasn't necessarily very well implemented. We were still kind of new at that. But it was basically a collectathon where once you collect all these mushrooms in this forest, one of the trees would turn into a dragon and chase you, and you had to run to your house. Very, very simple, but it was... Yeah, it was very fun. So that was the first game. That was in Unity. I'm not going to go over every game I've ever made in a game jam, but yeah, there was a lot of fun with. I generally found I gravitated towards like stories and narratives and kind of like, you know, kind of telling the player about, you know, the world that was going that was that we were the game was set in. Working with like teams, first global game jam was a game called Guitaria, which was a lot of fun. It was a platformer, again in Unity, where a guitar pick, like it's like a platform, it jumps on the musical notes as they move across the screen. Not quite implemented as much as you might like, but it was in terms of the programming, there's a lot of things that kind of never got quite implemented correctly, but the art was amazing. We had music. It was really cool. And there's also a very fun story that came along with it. And this was the first time I'd actually worked on a project, and we had a writer. So I ended up being more the project manager, programmer person. So that was a lot of fun to watch someone else writing a story for a game and seeing something come to life from the vantage point of like a project management type person. There's all different kinds of games. Then there's a Construct 2 game that I made with my husband and Ryan. And that was, what was it? I forget. Yeah, relentlessly random rumble or something, where you get random. You're trying. It's a platformer. You try to get to the end of the game. Meanwhile, you're randomly cycling through weapons, and the more weapons you get, some of them are useful, some of them aren't. Like there's a beaker that will work once and then break, and then every time you get it, you cycle through it, you have a handful of broken glass that does damage to you and that kind of thing. And you have an arrow, you have a bow and arrow, and you only have one arrow, you know. So, and that was a lot of fun to work on that.
I'll have to get that to her.
Thanks. Sorry about that. Open Spaces was another large team and awesome game, because like a group of a very creative people, and everyone was getting along so well on that team. That was amazing. It was we did very well. Especially considering narrative games, you know, not necessarily the most popular on for Ludum Dare, but yeah, we had a really cool team. And so, yeah, I've worked in Unity, Construct, and Construct's really nice to build things, though. I've also had, I'll bring it up. I tried to make a game about, I don't even remember what I called it, but it was for the Out of Power theme. I tried to make a game where you have the a little rover on a planet far, far away. and it was supposed to be this little, have a story where, you know, you're going back and forth between the satellite that's sort of above, you know, because sort of communicating, two AIs communicating to each other and trying to make sure you don't run out of power and don't, you'll have dust storms and stuff like that. But I did too much stuff, and I ran out of events because I'm using the free version of Construct too. Yeah, and that went down in flames. That was the most embarrassing game. that was me trying to do something all on my own. So I learned my lesson. Work with a team. Work with, be social.
Was your colonization game a Dari, or what's
colonization, which planetary data? That one actually was for Proc Jam.
Ah, okay.
That was a game jam, but that was like I had a month to work on that, I think, or a week. So that's a bit different. But yeah, that one was a fun one to work on. But I had more time, so yeah. I don't know how it works with this panel, but I feel like that one had a lot of bugs at the end of it, but I kept tweaking it and working on it. But I still need to work on that game. That's a game that had gotten like the most positive, in any game that I've worked on by myself. Now, if I could get some real art for that game, it'd be fantastic. I did work on a game for One Day Jam, and that was basically a fundraiser for a group in the UK that was funding healthcare for trans individuals, transgender. Yeah, and that was a lot of fun. And it was basically a narrative game, so I kept the scope very, very small. So if you're gonna work by yourself, work very small. but that was a lot of fun too, just because I kept it simple and very direct. Anyway, I know Taro's going to have some good stuff to say about this.
Yeah.
Yeah, what phases, steps, etc. do you recommend breaking the time into? Recommendations are one thing. Personal, actual, real-life personal experience, totally different. Okay. The first evening, we're not too bad about this, is you come up with the idea. You break down, who's going to do what. That's usually, once the theme has been unveiled, you get your idea, you get your team, you figure out what people are going to do generally, get everyone's contact info, and generally my experience is you kind of go and rest and kind of sleep on it and think about it. We recommend sleeping and taking care of eating and taking care of yourself during jams. Don't burn the candle at both ends. Yes, eat and sleep. And if you need a break, take a break. So then the next day, you're supposed to kind of try to have like some kind of demo. I try to have it by the mid-afternoon. I know Taro probably has a different kind of schedule. That doesn't always happen, especially with larger teams. And you usually have to have some, you want to have some kind of playable demo but I try to have one by the end of the day, but frequently it goes off into Sunday, well into Sunday before I have a game that's playable in the way that I expect it to be played. Also, when you're working with a group of people, you want to make sure that if somebody's supposed to be working on something, or somebody needs something from someone else, you want to make sure that, they do that before, pretty early on. So you want to make sure that you have your, and this is just for any project, any software project, make sure you have your dependencies figured out to a certain extent. You can't put in place assets that don't exist yet. And you can't really demo a game if you haven't, written any code or anything like that. I think Tara's probably a better person to talk about how you're supposed to do it or how you should do it. It's hard to do. One of the games I had actually a lot of fun making that we didn't have a game idea until Sunday morning. we finally settled on something, and that was We Are Here to Help, and that was a narrative game about aliens building the pyramids, and that was a fun game, but yeah, that broke all the rules, because we had a project idea first in the evening. We tried working on it all day Saturday. We were like, we scrapped it, started over Sunday morning, and we had something. But yeah, it's scoping is important.
Yes. Okay, I can... This is a classic case of do as I say, not as I do, because I fail miserably on this. Frederika here can vouch, and Muse, for that matter, can vouch. Yes, attest. Me panicking at the very end of the game jam. Oh, yeah. No, you might look at the quality of my games and be like, this guy is the most amazing person that he can make some of these games so entirely solo. How does he do it? And the answer is a lot of panic. Yeah. Oh, yeah. No, I freak out at the very end myself. This is such a heavy topic that I could go on forever on. So I'm going to try to keep this to an absolute minimum, to the best that I can. I'm running with the assumption, because of the title of the talk, that you're going to be participating in Ludum Dare, and you're probably inside your living room right now and thinking to yourself, like, all right, either I'm going to do it with myself, or we're going to have a party here with my friends working on a game. First of all, you're going to want to start planning. Preparation is by and far critical. And by that, I mean actually put down a schedule. We already talked about sleep, eat, actually write that down as part of your schedule. And in fact, like, I would just put an alarm clock somewhere and have everyone that is in part of your team agree that you will put your pencils down. You will walk to the kitchen and start eating food. I would also recommend, actually, just to make things a little more quicker, to get a bunch of either takeouts or frozen food so that you can make the cooking process a lot quicker, which is what I did for my first jam when I first conducted Ludum Dare. You know, just other any sort of time-saving measures. And trying to remember what other time-saving measures. Oh, so a while back, I said I lost my thought on the team part. I would highly recommend learning how to use version control if you have any coders. Actually, even if you're an artist or a musician, I would still recommend learning how to use version control as well. It is an incredibly useful backup system, and knowing how to use it will save the coder's life by a significant mile.
Yeah.
Other than that, during the actual, and obviously, you know, learn your craft, learn whatever tool you're going to be using, Photoshop, GIMP, Blender, what have you, or whatever game engine you're going to be learning, Unreal, Unity, so on and so forth. Any prior knowledge before the jam always, always helps. Even if you feel really, really like you don't know how to get started, though, I would still recommend participating in the game jam nonetheless. There are a lot of them going on in the world. One failure is not particularly that bad in the grand scheme of things. You always have a second chance, a third chance, a fourth chance. So don't feel bad if you're not able to complete the game in time. All right, so I wrote a list to myself. Preferably on day one, which never happens for me, is to implement the minimum viable product. So I mentioned earlier that you know, you should try to make your game design one sentence long. This MVP should demonstrate exactly that sentence, has no ending, no beginning, no menu, does not matter, just demonstrates that. Important to this is confirming that it does exactly what you think it does, and looking for any flaws in that game design. If it's significantly flawed to a point where you think to yourself you cannot continue further, I would throw that prototype away and try to come up with something else. I also, I forgot to mention that we usually spend here, when we do our real world meeting, an hour to do the brainstorming session. I would devote about an hour on brainstorming and try to come up with a decision by then. I use what I call a brain dump method, where we just try to list out, I just try to list out as many game ideas as I can and choose my favorite one there. Once you have the minimum viable product, add a few features to it that extends that game mechanic, then work on levels and polish. Now, it's incredibly mixed as to when I actually figure out the time to put these together, which is usually why I end up panicking at the very end. But ideally, the add new features and work on levels is something you do on day two, and polish is day three material. But yeah, no, I don't do a very good job of following this plan at all.
So on the heels of very serious business, I'm going to give you some more very serious business, kind of from a project management perspective, because I've done a lot of that. So you were talking, Taro was talking about brainstorming. Brainstorming is possibly the most critical part of game jam. Just, you know, coming up with a viable idea, you know, kind of assessing each other's skill sets, what you're able to do, what you're not able to do. If you don't know how to do anything related to game development, that's okay. You should come anyway, because chances are there is something that you know how to do, whether it's from playing lots of video games and kind of gaining, you know, at least a lay understanding of how good game design works. Maybe you've casually done like some Photoshop or Illustrator so you can make graphics. Maybe you've tinkered around with some digital audio workstations. You can do some sound design. Everybody knows how to do something. It's like, maybe you just haven't figured out that that's something you know how to do yet. So about what you know how to do and encourage your teammates to do the same. We've talked about the maintenance of the corporeal form. I cannot emphasize that enough. You must eat and drink. You must sleep or your product will be rubbish no matter what. And also, in addition to your product being rubbish, you will kind of hate yourself. I can also not emphasize enough, please, for the love of everything holy, do not spend your entire weekend eating junk food and drinking soda. Your body will hate you. Your brain is going to work a lot better when it's sloshing around in a nice water bed. It's well hydrated. It's ready to go. You know, so drink a lot of water. I mean, not that soda is, you know, verboten. Just don't overdo it. You know, make sure you're getting, you know, some good nutritional intake, you know, fruits, veggies, whatever. I know I sound like a nutritionist, but really it's good advice, I promise. Make sure that you prepare for the worst possible scenario, meaning you may start a game jam and be super enthusiastic about it, and you may lose some of your teammates along the way. You may also discover that you are the only person in the entire game jam who knows how to do something really specific. For example, typically when I do a game jam, with one exception being Tess, so one time I worked in a game with Tess, I was the only person in the room who knew how to compose music. Nobody else under, you know, any of the game jams I ever participated in knew about either electronic or classical composition, for in any medium, for anything really. So the same game jam that we built Open Spaces on, I ended up composing not only for Open Spaces, but for two other games in the same weekend because Tess couldn't be there the whole time. And I was the only other person who knew how to do sound design and composition. So, you know, I'm cranking out the soundtrack for, you know, for Open Spaces. And Greg and William were doing this game called Thin the Herd. And they needed like a bunch of weather sound effects. So I'm like in the kitchen running the sink, clanking stuff, you know, doing sound design for their weather stuff. And then I think I did one of your games that same weekend, but I don't remember which one it was. I know it wasn't the body horror game. It was something else. Was it? Salty Scuttle is adorable and I love it. It might have been the Salty Scuttle. So either way, I'm running around like a chicken with my head cut off because obviously I wanted to help everybody kind of, you know, achieve at least part of their vision. So it was a bit much, but I guess, long story short, Yeah, you're going to run into a skills shortfall at some point in your game jam, at least occasionally. But I guess the upshot of my story is, you know, these other teams came to me and said, hey, we really don't have anybody doing sound. Can you help us? And of course, I went, yeah, I will totally help you. I cannot write you an entire OST, but I will give you at least the bare bones, you know, structure of a soundscape or, you know, music or what have you. So that's what I did. So it's totally okay to ask for help if you, you know, if you don't have somebody that does art, if you don't have somebody that codes, or, you know, somebody randomly get sick or something comes up or they're just like, hey, I just don't want to do it. You know, that's okay. Game jams, teams aside, hey, thank you. It's meant to be a big collaboration. So it's okay to approach another team and be like, yo, this person was doing X, Y, Z and now they're not. Can you maybe help us fill in a little bit of the gap? That's okay. Lastly, and I say this as a many, many, many years long veteran of creative work, even if you limit your prototype, which you should, you are never going to get 100% of the result that you want, even for a base prototype. That should not discourage you from building a game. It should only encourage you to build what you can, as I mentioned earlier, build a foundation and then just keep building on it. Keep, you know, developing that game. Maybe say to your team members, especially if you have a good experience, like, hey, let's continue working on, case in point, you know, let's keep working on this product. Let's make it good. Maybe, you know, maybe we'll found a game studio. Maybe we'll ship it on a couple of different platforms. Maybe we'll make some money. Who knows? You know, you never know. So yeah, just treat it as a learning experience and an opportunity to meet other cool people that are really into the idea of game development and doing that professionally or even just casually, and you will have a good time. Just don't be upset with yourself if you don't achieve 100% of the results that you were aiming for, because you never will. That is always the case, and it doesn't mean that you suck. So just, you know, reasonably assess your skills, maintain your corporeal form, and have a good time.
So I'm next on coming up with a question. Very, 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 very real quick. I promise this will be short. I'm going to contradict myself by saying these are just advices. If it does not work out for you, try something else. Not everyone works the same way. All right, so the first question I pulled out, and I swear we're going to have to move to the next question after this. What games have you made for a game jam? We already answered that question.
Yeah, that's fine.
So hopefully this is the question that our guest here submitted. Do many mechanics, if any, tend to naturally appear in the development process that wind up in the finished product? Or have you ever completed a jam without a brainstorming session? I guess I will start with what I think is the meaning of this question. You can correct me if I am wrong. So most of the time when I'm doing a game, I am running with a hypothesis. I'm thinking that this game mechanic that I have in mind achieves the experience that I am aiming for. Notice my wording. I'm not necessarily looking for a fun game. I'm looking for a game that achieves a specific, you know, scratch itch on me. So sometimes things do occur in that process that either makes me change my mind, or I try to end up focusing on something else. The aforementioned Suddenly Thousands is an excellent example of this. I accidentally dropped two characters in the game that you can control, and I just thought that was far more fun and completely changed my mind that way. So yes, that can happen for, you know, bugs or things to appear in the game that I'm just like, this is a really nice happy accident. I'm willing to run with it. Other times, like, I don't think I've ever went into a game jam without a brainstorming session ever. It's just a personal philosophy of mine, having been to mostly like Ludum Dare and Global Game Jam, to not come in with a game jam with a game in mind at all. because I'm expecting the theme to not follow it whatsoever. That said, I, like Jamie Stevenson, who is not here, but he often mentioned that he has this specific strategy, like have a lot of game ideas in mind anyways. So every once in a while, a theme would be so perfect that I'm like, I have to make this game idea that I had in mind, which is how Through Oneself was born. Like, I had that game idea since high school, and I just like really wanted to see if I can pull it off. But most of the time, it's just things like, you know, most of the time when I come to a game jam, I'm making a game where I just never even imagined it. I just thought it was interesting to put together. And yeah, that I'm surprised that the grand majority of my time, my hypotheses are often correct, even though I'm always skeptical that they are not.
So can I see that for a minute, actually? I want to make sure I'm not... In response to the question about mechanics, I think, yeah, because, I mean, you know, game mechanics will sometimes just happen by accident. You know, you might just be, you know, just kind of tinkering around in game engine, whatever, and be like, oh, I did this thing. This is cool. I should keep this, kind of a thing. So I think, you know, game mechanics just naturally appearing is a result of just kind of experimenting with, you know, whatever game engine you're utilizing, or just experimenting with your code, and kind of seeing what it's capable of. So yes. For the second question, have you ever completed a game jam without a brainstorming session? Yes. I do not recommend it, if for no other reason that it is more stressful to complete a game jam without a brainstorming session first, and I am a high stress person to begin with. So if you tend to kind of freak out a little easily or get very like tense if you don't have a plan, it's definitely not super advisable. But even if you're just a very go with the flow kind of person, it's such a compressed amount of time to complete anything that it can really make you feel a lot more confident in your approach to whatever it is that you're building if you've done a brainstorming session first. There was one game jam where I was not able to attend the first evening's festivities, which I was a little salty about, but I had good reason for not being there. So, you know, I asked if everybody could like just kind of you know, post their brainstorming sessions or their ideas somewhere, so I could, you know, come in with some semblance of an idea of like what I wanted to contribute or which team I wanted to join. Nobody did. So I'm just like, well, so I kind of showed up and was like, okay, what's everybody working on? And I found out what everybody was working on, and then I just kind of, you know, hopped on a couple of games. But it was it would have been nice to have that kind of preparation, especially considering that the day before Friday was really, really hectic for me. And I was like, I'm really excited about this game jam, but I'm so anxious because I have no idea what it is and what I'm going to do. And I didn't have time to look at the Ludum Dare website to figure out what the theme was. But some good products came out of that, so we can't be too pressed.
Okay, well, in my experience, I don't know, every time I do a game jam, I have no idea what I'm going to get into. Yes. I'll answer the first part first, but then I'll go into the second part first, actually. I've never completed a jam. I was just QA at the very end, so I don't know if I really count that. I don't feel like it doesn't feel like a proper game jam if you don't do a brainstorming session. You know, that's like my favorite part. You sit there and every idea can be interpreted in multiple ways. So every time you write an idea, there's like at least, you know, there's one, two, three, you know, ideas and ways to implement it. There's so many different types of games out there. So you can have an idea about changing shapes, and you can have an idea about what changes shape. and sometimes, or, you know, is it a story about somebody changing shapes, or is it, you know, something, you know, the map changing shape, or is it just shapes that are changing? So, you know, it's a really fun exercise to just get a theme idea and just run with it. So that's my favorite part, is getting the theme and being like, okay, let's go. Now, I generally, there's some, and when you have an idea, that kind of going back to the game mechanics, when you have an idea, some game mechanics just sort of naturally fall out of an idea. You know, platformers come out of certain ideas. You know, narrative games, interactive fiction comes out of other ideas. It's just some, and that's that does tend to, once you have an idea, it does kind of naturally go in a certain direction. You'll generally see, and the fun thing about Ludum Dare is you get to play the games that other people have made, and you're supposed to, actually. It's part of the rating process. You play each other's games, you rate them, they rate your game, and that way you all kind of get like feedback from other people. Sometimes it's helpful, sometimes it's not, but generally, for the most part, it's helpful. I've only had a few comments that I've been like, really? But yes, mostly people are helpful. Generally, I try to follow a formula. I try to give constructive feedback. If I don't like a game at all, I generally won't put any kind of feedback at all. I try to say, you know, oh, this was a really cool idea. You could have improved it by this. There are just certain things you always see. You always see platformers. Always. There's certain genres that just come up because they're very familiar. So if there's a very popular, you know, you have your first person shooter, walking simulator, there's certain game mechanics that are just easier to do in a compressed time scale. Then of course there's stuff that's just off the wall and you're like, wow, this person just sees something, it's completely different. Taro being actually a really good example, who happens to be here in the room, but but it's very true. But then there's just people who come up with these really strange experiences. They're not proper games, and well, I mean, they're games. I don't want to knock them and say that they're not games, but they're not games in the way you would think of games. You know, they're not conventional. They're more experiences. They're more artistic, and I don't know if those naturally come out of anything other than the person who created them. So that's sort of my experience. I highly recommend, even if you don't do the game jam, do a game jam, to check out the games created during a game jam, because you'll see very unconventional ideas, conventional ideas with twists, you know, and sometimes you'll see somebody doing something for the very first time, and it's really cool to watch somebody, you know, watch someone's progress that way. Okay.
Cool. Shall we move on? I was going to ask if we want to move on to the next question.
Yeah. Really briefly, can we run with the assumption that people know what mechanic stands for? Let's just make it. Yeah.
Yes.
Brief explanation of mechanics. They are the rules of the game. Done. I was also going to make a quick shout out of the MDA model, or the mechanics, dynamics, aesthetics. Look it up.
Thank you. Why attend a game jam? I got some thoughts about this. Well, so the first time I ever attended a game jam, if memory serves, was last March, April, something like that. It was kind of warm, so I'm pretty sure it was spring. And I came with very little knowledge, if any, of how the game development industry worked, how, you know, common tools worked, you know, like game engines, that sort of thing. I just knew that I was really, really interested in becoming a video game composer. And the subsequent result is that a year later, after, you know, spending a lot of time in the game space, doing lots of game jams, you know, helping other people with their games, I founded a game studio. So if, even if you don't have a specific goal in mind when you attend a game jam, you just want to learn something, you want to meet some new people that are interested in the same kind of stuff as you are, all those are good reasons. If you want to launch a career in game development and you don't necessarily want to attend a high-priced college or university, you want to gain the necessary skills to make games, you should attend a game jam. Like, I didn't know that I wanted to found a studio when I started doing game jams. That came later. But I can say definitively that doing game jams launched my career as a video game composer. So whether your goal is casual or your goal is serious, there's a lot of good reasons to do it, even if for no other reason that, you know, you're looking for a community. And I've definitely found a wonderful community of people who have, you know, supported me and taught me, including these two right here. And, you know, just kind of encouraged me in whatever direction I wanted to go. And you will meet people like that, whether you just make games on the weekends or whether you decide, hey, you know what, I want to go up the hill to RPI or over to SUNY Polytech and I want to work for Blizzard. I want to work for Vicarious Visions, or I want to work for First Play at Ball. It doesn't matter what your goal is. If you do a game jam, you're going to get something positive out of it if you bring a positive attitude with you.
This is definitely a question that is better suited for Muse and Frederika, since I have made so many games at this point that I probably completely forgot the original reason why I even got into game jams from the first place. I probably have some recollections, but instead I'm going to approach this question from a completely different angle. You've made games. You know what game making is like. Why approach game jam from the first place at all? Well, I, as an individual who probably knows a lot about Unity, often use game jams as an opportunity to learn like a specific feature that I was really interested in for Unity itself, or Blender as it may for specifically the recursive dollhouse. So that one was mostly a modeling exercise for me. Anyways, by modeling, I mean that's a 3D term, not actual getting up in front of the stage kind of modeling. Anyways. So, with that in mind, this is just me as an individual. I find it difficult to kind of learn and really understand a feature or like a thing or a concept as in coding. So, usually I have a easier time to understand it when I have an end motivation, like this is the product that is going to be generated as a consequence of me learning this feature. That usually really helps me. And maybe a lot of coders out there are like me, where you know, having results, clear results, as a way of you learning your way through new features is how you learn best. For people like you, game jams are fantastic, and I will take every opportunity to join as many as you can, you know, without exhausting yourself, participate in.
For me, every time I've done a game jam, it's been a very different set of reasons as I've sort of progressed through, as I've grown as a game developer, as a programming, as somebody who mentors other people. When I first started, it was all about learning how to make a game and just having something that was made at the end of the weekend. That, you know, that's a pretty cool achievement. You spend your weekend, you know, you could just, you know, watch TV, binge watch Netflix or something, or you can make a game. And each time it's been a little bit more, you know, I try something new. I meet new people. I I get to mentor, and now that I know more about games, I get to mentor people. I get to see someone go from not knowing how to make games, and I do teach a class usually on Saturday mornings for the game jams. I try to do it every time, but sometimes it's a little sort of tricky. I try to do a class, and I try to get people to the point where they're like, okay, I can make my own game, and they can finish something at the end of the weekend, which is, you know, very rewarding. It's like you basically get to see someone achieve a goal, and you get to help them do it, and that's really awesome. It started out very selfish, and then kind of gets more, you know, community and, you know, being part of a community. Also, watching people, we all start from the same theme, and everybody interprets it in a different way. Sometimes people are more, you know, abstract games, you know, or something more narrative, more, you know, standard platformer. Somebody does, you know. Yeah, yeah, it's so cool to watch someone, and what cool. It's kind of cool also to see someone go, you know, do a new thing each jam too. It's always fun to watch what Taro is working on. He's always doing something interesting.
Yeah.
But it's also fun to watch somebody who you know didn't necessarily who just is just starting their journey in making games, and maybe they make something fairly simple, or maybe they make something that's very creative, and you would never have thought of that in a million years. But they're making a game for the first time, and it's very different. And one of the people it was a game with like the light would damage you or something. Yeah, it was a platformer, but it was a really creative game, and it was really cool to watch him make that game. There's a lot of reasons, and there are a lot of reasons that I do it, and there's a lot of reasons other people do it, so. Yes, there we go.
Next question.
Oh. Yeah. This is an important question.
Oh, yes.
This is so important.
Oh, let's have it.
Do I need to know programming?
No!
No! Even if you are the only one making the game, you do not need to know programming. There are tools available to you, and this is cool. I get to talk about this. There are game engines that do not require any programming. The one I primarily use and recommend is Construct. There's Construct 2, which is Windows only, and there's Construct 3, which is browser based. It just basically it's, you know, if you can sort of set up logical scenarios and you can build a game. If you can figure out, think your way through what you want to happen in terms of cause and effect, you're good. It uses a graphical user interface and behaviors, and I can get someone started in it in about an hour. So and it is so much fun. I have a tutorial that I walk people through during Ludum Dare frequently. Usually on almost every Saturday morning now, when I'm able to come in, I walk people through it from 11 to 12:30. Just, you know, a little plug for beginner game design there. Yes, yes, yes. If you want to know how to make games without needing to know programming. Even if you know programming, it's a very easy game engine to use and to create something. You can run up against the limits for the free version. It does have some, it's not as flexible as some of the more powerful tools, but if you want to do something pretty standard, or you want to do something standard with a twist, it's a really good game engine to make 2D games. So no, you do not need to know programming, and we'll help you if you don't need know programming and you want to make your own game.
Only a small thing to add if you already wanted to learn programming, you know, what the heck are you waiting for? If you're telling yourself, I don't know much to get started on coding, like, take Frederika's route, learn a game engine that doesn't require it. Honestly, you're going to get faster results that way, and at least I definitely was more satisfied going that route instead.
All of the above, again. So while you don't need to know programming, and this is coming a little bit more from the professional side than the game jam side, if programming is something that interests you, definitely learn some. You know, Frederika can teach you some programming. Taro can teach you programming. You can use Code Academy, Udemy, anything like Coursera are all great options for learning programming. I'm actually going to be undertaking some programming study this year, not because I want to be a programmer, but because, you know, I work on a team of game developers, and me knowing some programming will hopefully allow me to assist Frederika in her role if she needs it, and also to enable me to better understand what the limitations of our creation really is. So, you know, by knowing programming, it will help me to be more effective in my own role. And it seems like a little bit weird to equate, composition and programming as like intersecting fields of study. But in reality, from an academic perspective, all fields of study are connected with each other, even if that connection isn't immediately obvious. But all that aside, programming doesn't have to be like, you know, some kind of horrendous nightmare. There's a lot of different ways to go about learning programming, and they do not have to be unpleasant. And lastly, if you want to learn programming, whether it's for game jams or for, you know, any other purpose, really, you can come here and learn programming for free. So why not?
All right.
Just a quick plug for on our website, if you go to techvalleygamespace.com, click on the Learn link, we have a bunch of tutorials on programming, on Construct, RenPy, which I frequently use for interactive storytelling, and also Twine. Yep, Twine as well.
Well, most of them are from the templates. How to balance fun of making games versus quality of the game itself? This is actually a question I personally wrote, as probably viewers have seen. So my question when I come to this is, how do you balance, like, what do you usually focus on? Making, trying to make the process of making that game fun more, or trying to focus on the quality of the game more? I want to know both of your thoughts first, if you don't mind me asking.
So, what's it? Sorry, let's make sure I got how to balance the fun of making games versus the quality of the game. Well, as Muse and I myself have stated, you really want to make sure you take care of yourself. So, don't sacrifice yourself for the quality of the game, or your health and well-being, and just general well-being. So, I think that, honestly, I think if you're having fun making a game, usually it is it's quality. It's going to be a quality game. I generally just making sure you're taking care of yourself, you're keeping perspective on what you're doing and not getting, you know, down a rabbit hole. Scoping is very important. I mentioned this before, but I don't think I defined the terms. You know, scoping is basically, you know, you break down, you know, what you can, your priorities, what you can do in the given time. So you don't, you know, so if you can keep your priorities straight and keep track of what you're doing, it helps to make sure that, you know, it's fun, because you're not like getting stressed out trying to do five different things in some order. It helps if you can focus and do it well. So, try not, you know, not stressing yourself out, I think goes for both of them, both the quality and the fun. Because if you're stressing yourself out, you're not going to have a good game. Every game I've ever made where I was like really stressed out, it's not really has come out the best. So I think I just think you know, if you make sure things are fun and keep yourself in good shape, you're going to balance that very well. Okay.
Yay. This is kind of a difficult question, actually. I would agree with everything that Frederika just said. But I feel like having fun and making a good quality game is dependent on a couple of things that I've previously mentioned, not to toot my own horn. In my experience, it is partially dependent on joining a team that you can fairly readily communicate with, and making sure that you and your team members have a positive attitude about what you're doing, no matter what it is that you're building. Because if you approach, and this is true of really anything that you do, even outside of game jams, if you approach a game jam from a place of, you know, joy and love of, you know, learning of game development or even just of games themselves, you're probably going to have a really good time. I have been extremely fortunate to have met a lot of people doing game jams that approach, you know, the project from that kind of perspective, that they're really, you know, they're excited to learn something. They're excited to build something, even if it's like a small something. So if you wind up on a team with somebody who's really negative about what you're there to do, maybe don't be on that team, you know? But I actually haven't personally witnessed that yet. You know, sometimes people get a little frustrated because like, oh, the code doesn't work or crap. I can't get this, you know, this one song file to, you know, condense small enough to fit into like the prototype that we're building. And, you know, so there's like these little frustrations that you run into along the way, but it shouldn't cloud the overall big picture that like you're there to build something cool.
So, my opinion is, if you're not having fun in a game jam, it's probably not for you.
Yes.
Not that long while ago, we had the question of why do you attend a game jam? I could have, now that I think of it, summarized it in only a few words, which is because it's fun. Mm-hmm. If you're just not participating it for the purpose of having fun, then I feel like you're approaching game jam the wrong way.
Absolutely. Because it's supposed to be fun.
Mm-hmm. As someone who actually spends the time trying to make sure the game is to the standard that I want it to be, I feel like that step is not all that important for most people, myself included, which might be a bit surprising to hear. I guess like a lot of my joy is coming out from, you know, the joy of making it primarily. I've definitely made terrible games on purpose, that is, as well as terrible games not on purpose. But I don't think I've ever came out on a game jam thinking to myself, this was the worst thing ever. I am never going to do this again. Or like, most of the time, if there's something that did not work out, it's largely, I'll probably come back to myself and say, all right, well, what could I have done better next time so I could enjoy the next jam a little better. Yeah. I'm trying to think of situations where quality like really matter to me. I will say this. If you're like feeling super duper nervous and like you're just absolutely nerve-wracked, and you're just not able to come up with a game within the first hour or the second hour, or it's now the last day and you still haven't come up with a game idea, might I recommend trying to make a terrible game, like an outright terrible game, because you can do no wrong at the very end of that. If a game comes out and it is glitchy, well, you've achieved the very purpose that you were setting out for, right? Okay, that's not exactly the best advice ever, but I don't know. It might be worth... I do recommend trying to make terrible games and asking a question of, like, what makes a game... What makes to you a game really good? And have, like, a game that is absolutely terrible contrast with that, and, like, it kind of helps your perspective on things.
Can we do one more? Because this is really good.
Sure.
Okay.
What do you consider a big pro to designing a game in a small time span? I think I have a couple of different responses to this. I'm going to keep it short. It teaches you to think very creatively. It teaches you to plan. And it teaches you how to effectively collaborate with other people. And all of those are skills that you can that are broadly applicable to literally every area of your life.
Uh-huh. It's a really good way of standing out from AAA industry, because every AAA industry are made with an intent of, you know, taking as much of your time as possible. Whereas, you know, if you're trying to make a game that in a small time frame, that is already out of picture. You're not going to do that. I also like to think that that gives you an excuse to come up with some really crazy stuff. I consistently rank lowest on theme, believe it or not. Like, I have a very loose interpretation of theme when it comes to Ludum Dare, and I'm okay with that. I have a rather scattered brain when it comes to trying to make connections to the theme, and then I start making, like, third degree, fourth degree, fifth degree. Okay, this doesn't really have to do with the theme at all, but I kind of care about this idea. But, you know, it's a good way of just kind of letting your own creativity get a little loose, get a little crazy, and have fun doing it.
I agree with both what Muse and Taro have said, so I'll add one other thing. If what you're doing doesn't work, you aren't spending a really long time on it. you get to learn from the mistakes and everything, but you don't have to, like, commit to it much longer than a week. So if something isn't working, or it's an idea and you're trying something you've never done before and it's not really coming together, it's okay, you know? Next time you can start over. Next game jam, you're good. So that's what I would add to that.
So I think the takeaway from all this is that game jams are super fun and they are super instructive, and I would really, really, really love to see you at Ludum Dare at the end of this month. So you should come and be nerdy and make games, because it's really, we've talked about a lot of serious stuff, but it is super fun and you will 99% possibility have a great time.
I forgot to mention that a wrong way of participating in a game jam is entering it with a mindset that it is a competition. This is completely wrong, and definitely, as a final thought, I think it's very critical to address as well. If you are entering a game jam, I personally like to think of it as a really nice social networking event, as well as just generally a good time to be with motivated people, be with people who are really empowering themselves, and by demonstrating that, empowering others as well into creating a game. Honestly, like, you know, we have Frederika and Muse here saying, like, my games are really good and all that sort of stuff. And I will humbly say, like, oh, they're not that good. But I think that even as you're surrounded, like, by people like me, we are also human beings as well. We are also attending game jams with the very intent of having fun, just having trying to get to know with all the other people around, and then so forth. I think that It's easy to compare yourself to other people, but don't do that. Walking into a game jam, think of it as you challenging yourself to be the best and to really show off what you can do to the world. And I think that'll make your experience that much better.
Yeah, one of the things that really is cool about game jams. I'm not really the most social person, honestly, but game jams have helped me come out of my shell. And I'm kind of the kind of person who will I like to know exactly what I'm going to be doing all weekend. And this is definitely great because it gets me out of that kind of, I'm just going to do the same thing kind of mindset. It's challenging. I've discovered stuff, things about myself, the way I think and the way other people think. And it's such a positive experience, especially here. I haven't done too many game jams in person. I've done Global Game Jam with the IGDA, Albany, but that's practically the same group, almost. There's a lot of overlap. But it's a very positive experience doing game jams. And yes, come on down, challenge yourself, learn what you're capable of, and we'll help you. So, there you go. Oh, yes.
So, quick plug, Ludum Dare happens every April and October. If you are watching this live stream right now, the latest one that's coming up is April 26th. So, you should totally sign up at ldjam.com. This is not, paid by Ludum Dare. It's almost done entirely through volunteer work anyway. But I highly, highly recommend that. It is entirely online, so if you happen to be in the opposite side of the world or the opposite side of the coast, as it may be, since our nation is large enough to do for us to say that, just sign up on the website and so forth. If you happen to be in the local area, welcome. Totally come to our location. yeah.
Thank you, everyone, for tuning in. Feel free to watch our other stuff on the Learn channel, on the YouTube channel. Tune into Twitch and YouTube and Facebook. Follow us on Facebook. Support us on Patreon.